Dear Heavenly Father, we praise your holy name, Lord God. We thank you, Father. Father, thank you for your patience with us. Thank you for being so merciful, so loving, so kind, a good, good Father. And thank you, Jesus, for sitting by his right hand and being our advocate and explaining. I don't really even understand how it works. But we know that the word says that you advocate on our behalf. So obviously there must be some dynamic associated with your presence here in this earth in the flesh that gives you a different perspective perhaps on things that we are going through. And you're able to convey those things in our defense to the Father when we're going through difficult times and making adjustments in our lives. And we just love you for that, Jesus. We just want to thank you. We want to thank you for all of the things you suffered. We want to thank you for all of the temptations that you've endured. We want to praise your holy name for we can't even imagine what you went through. The very, very small amount of real estate in the Bible associated with the Gospels barely even touches upon the 33 plus years of your life that you spent. It's just unfathomable to imagine how awesome and how much you went through, and what an incredible example that you are for all of us, and how uniquely qualified you are to be our advocate and to speak on our behalf before the Father. Yeah, good times, bad times, happy, joyous, tear-filled nights, whatever it is, fear, anxiety, depression that comes upon us, so that you're always there. You're always at our side. You're always lifting us up and carrying us over the metaphorical hot coals in our lives. And we just thank you. We just want to give you all the praise and give you – there is never, ever, ever going to be enough of eternity for us to be able to show us the gratitude that we and the love that we have for you. We don't love you enough. We need to love you more. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that you will take a beautiful, just a diamond-studded, gorgeous, beautiful golden cup of trust. Golden cup of love and trust and faith, and just pour it out over each of us. Let it permeate the very particles that make up the energies that create us in this realm and this fearfully and wonderfully made bodies that we are in right now, that are so woefully inadequate in comparison to our spiritual bodies, that we're also hungrily waiting to be able to transform into as soon as possible, Lord, please. And we just thank you, Father, for being merciful enough to show us about the different harvests, to give us hope that we're not going to have to wait until the midst of the sixth seal or even later, and to be able to discern the stuff that's out there right now, Father, that is just, it's incorrect. And it's not that it's coming from bad people or people that aren't good Christians or aren't trying. It's just that we thank you, Father, for your holy word. We praise you so much. And we thank you for every time that you reveal something through the presence of the Holy Spirit when we are reading it, that helps us to have those aha moments, so that we know that when even people that have a good heart, even people that are trying their best to serve you, Father, are just, well, they're just way off and they don't understand. And we just praise you for your word. We thank you for your mercy. We pray that you will pour out that golden bowl of love and faith and trust into our hearts as we are in this interesting and unusual practice session to prepare us for the days that are coming ahead. We don't know how long and how far into the future, and we don't know how bumpy the roads will be on our way there, but we do know that we need to draw in closer. We need to have that trust. We can't let our cages get rattled, as it were, as we're getting, demonic tomatoes thrown at us, or probably more appropriately, demonic sharp, boulders whipped at our heads as we go through our daily life. We just praise you for being there for us. Praise you for being a good, good Father. Thank you, Jesus, for advocating on our behalf and always being it by our side and ready to help us through even the darkest days and most depressed days, and to be able to bring that joy back into our heart as we, well, anxiously await the transformation of our bodies and to be able to stand before you, our King. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you, Father. Amen. Well, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. And another week. That's been an interesting week. The reason why I canceled the Wednesday show is because there's no point in having a grumpy, bummed out, depressed Johnny on the program. That's the last thing anybody would want to listen to anyway. And I'm not here to do that. You know, we all go through our ups and downs. You know, some of us go through a few extra ones, you know, now and then. Sometimes it's not just a frying pan that's being whacked up inside of your head. In some cases, it's a, you know, ow, a giant boulder, you know, with sharp, jagged edges, and it's getting, you know, and stuff happens. And so it just, you know, to some of us, it just seems to happen, you know, a little bit more often than some others. So, you know, so I am righteously in a righteous way, if there is a such thing, you know, envious of any of you out there who the devil is essentially leaving alone and you're not getting pummeled on the head on a regular basis. Just about the time, you know, you're coming up for air, you're getting yourself dusted off, things are getting starting to look good again, you know, your prayer life is back where you want it to be and the time is right and you're working out every morning and you know, and stuff is just, you know, all right, and all of a sudden, bam, it's like, are you kidding me? It's kind of like, you know,
are you serious? Are you serious?
Yeah, it's like you get on the phone with your boss, you know, you get your little one-on-one, and you know, he's like, excuse me, but this, that, and the other thing, and then, you know, it's like, okay. All right. So at that point, it's kind of like, you know, I was so like, you know, I need one of those clowns. Remember those things? I wonder if you could still buy them. I want to look it up here on Amazon.com and see if they have one. Because you know what? I think they might have one. They might sell them. Those. I'll just type in here, punching clown. It even says with weighted base for kids or whatever. Let's see if. Well, yeah, there's one. There's one like a dinosaur. You got some. Hey, they even have a Donald Trump one. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. But yeah, they've got these little, you know, clown things, you know, or whatever, in different shapes and things that, you know, have a little weighted bottom and you blow them up. And then when you've had all you can take and you can't take it no more, you can go over and punch that clown right in the head. All right. Anyway, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. But anyway, yeah. So it's been that kind of a week. But, you know, sometimes, you know, I don't have an assistant pastor. You know, there were times back in the early days with Kenneth and Kathy and all that kind of stuff that I had, you know, a beautiful luxury associated with, you know, being able to, you know, I had things I had to do, you know, that a lot of times they were associated with my job, travel, you know, can really stomp a radio show scheduled date and stuff like that. And then, you know, Kenneth could, you know, take over the program or whatever, and we'll do a show with Kathy or whatever, you know, but you know, normal churches, you know, instead of these electronic ecclesia types, they're going to have, you know, assistant pastors. There is, in some cases, they'll not have just one, but they'll have like two or more assistant pastors that aren't, you know, drawing a salary off the church or anything, but they, you know, they want to be a part of it, and they're working full-time jobs and doing this, that, and the other thing too, on top of it all, which is wonderful. Praise God. But they're, you know, they're chomping at the bit to get an opportunity to, you know, grab the podium and do a little bit of preaching. Praise God. So, you know, then the senior pastor can go with his wife out to do something, you know, take her out on a, maybe to a Bahama breeze and enjoy the ocean and watch some pelicans fly by or whatever. But anyway, you know, or just go into prayer and spend some alone time with the Lord if you're going through a tough time and, you know, and the rocks are flying your way from every different direction. Sometimes you just get pummeled over the head so many times. It's like, ow, ow, stop it, please. Hey, come on now. I didn't know. It wasn't my fault. I'm telling you guys. Oh, for crying out loud. And sometimes, you know, there's this, you're like, oh, yeah. And like in an hour, I got to do a radio show. Right, kids? Yeah, see, even you are smart enough to know. You don't want Grumpy Johnny getting on the radio show. And so I had to make a judgment call, and that's okay. No problem. You know, 4,000 plus shows under my belt. I think I can take a day off now and then. Praise Jesus. And for those of you who are like super duper ultra unbelievably kind and, you know, wrote me an email and, you know, and said, you know, you'll pray for me and you're hoping that everything is okay, or, you know, that you missed me and, you know, you look forward to me and laid a heavy guilt trip on me and all that kind of stuff. I just wanted to let you know that I love you. And I pray in Jesus' name, a tenfold blessing on every single one of you, every single person that prays for me, because I honestly believe sometimes, just based on the magnitude, the sheer magnitude of the things that have happened to me over the last 3 years, if I listened, if it wasn't, and it always seems to come from believers. That's the most amazing thing. It's not, the unbelievers are just nice as can be. I mean, you can walk up to a big old Harley Davidson skull wearing, tattooed, big, mean looking guy in a public supermarket and go over and say, "Hey, man, how's it going?" And he'll be just so friendly as can be. But boy, let me tell you what, you say something like that to a Christian, and the first thing you're going to do is look you up and down and try to figure out how much of a Pharisee they can be that day. And that's exactly how it is. And they're full of demons. My sister sends out, it's like she was surprised. And it's because, you know, the old 1960s, 1970s, you know, early 80s, charismatic movement type Pentecostal, you know, Assembly of God churches out there used to teach, and they probably still do, that Christians can't, you know, have demons in them, which is ridiculous because that's where they live, inside of Christians. If you were Satan, right, and you're like, okay, I'm going to send as many people to hell as I possibly can, right? So, so think about it just, you know, strategically, you know, or tactically even, and say to yourself, where are you going to waste your resources? Are you going to send a bunch of your best demons over to infest that group of people over there that are on an 8-lane freeway and Ferraris heading straight to hell? Or are you going to send the demons over there to plague the Christians and to reside inside of them? Oh, well, a demon can't possess a Christian. Yeah, don't be so sure about that. I'm here to tell you. I've had personal experience with that for many years. And if you heard the stories that I could tell, they would make any Amity Hill horror movie look like it was, Walt Disney World or Looney Tunes and, Snagglepuss, Exit, Stage Left. But they really did happen to me. And it's pretty scary stuff, but it's always comes from people who believe they're Christians, and it's sad. And it's a sad state of affairs. My sister sends out this email, you know, and she's like, you could tell, you know, just because of the way she capitalized letters and everything. And it was like a YouTube video, and it was like some pastor, and she's got like all of her friends listed all in there. And I'm in there too, of course. And she's like, she's like, and a big title on the YouTube video, Christians, possessed with demons. And here's the problem is the word possessed is tricky, because possession means that the demon is actually taking over your metabolic, body engines. Okay. So it's actually talking, it's talking through your throat. It's making you breathe and making your heart beat and controlling the actual biological, functions of the body. Okay, that's what true full-blown possession is. But demons living inside by the, you know, bazillions, I don't even know how many, I don't know. Oh, the scripture says, he'll go back to his house and take seven other demons more evil than himself, and they'll enter and dwell there. And the last state of the man will be worse than first, and so will it be with his weak generation. And, you know, and so we know that there's a bunch. There's a strong man, and there's usually some other ones in there too. Now, is there at any point that you're not being at least badgered by demons? Maybe they're not inside of you. I can tell you that when I went to the Bob Larson seminar that was free here in Tampa, thank God, he spent a lot of time explaining to people that it's in the churches where he finds the most people that are possessed that have demons inside of them. Let's just say that. There isn't a term for it. There really isn't. But there's demons residing inside of the vast majority of Christians. And because that's their prime target. That's what they're looking for. Okay. And that's where they want to reside. That is their mission, to take out Christians. And so, and my sister was sending out this YouTube video, and she's like, wow, this pastor says he's casting demons out of Christians. Like, it was like the epiphany of the century. Brand new Corvettes for $5.95 and that kind of thing. She was all kind of surprised. And I'm like thinking to myself, what? Have you been paying attention at all? But of course, I don't say anything. But yeah, no, it's man, folks, what we're going to see in the future man, what we're going to see in the future is going to make this coronavirus thing seem like a blip on the radar that we never even noticed. And it's just, and it's shocking, really. And this is a great wake-up call. Praise Jesus. It's a wonderful wake-up call. Hallelujah. Not only is this something that can generate a Jesus conversations in any group of people, anywhere in the world, you name it, pick the place, you can walk in, talk about the coronavirus, and with just the tiniest little bit of Q&A in a friendly manner, you can easily ask a couple of questions that steer the conversation over to this being a biblical issue. Which is great. Praise God. And it's waking a lot of people up, and it's helping people understand that they're not prepared. They don't have enough, you know, earthly supplies. And I'm not going to get into the itemized list of things that, you know, people ought to have around their house. But, you know, it does help you to assess where you are and how long, you know, you're hoping to, you know, you're going to have to weather the storm. You know, what happens if, you know, double asteroid hits the other side of the sun? That's pretty trustworthy vision, you know, dream that was given to somebody years ago. I wrote an article. Blue 21, it was in there. And, you know, giant EMP, you know, solar storm, Carrington event type thing comes rolling, you know, directly at the earth and just pummels it and takes out power grids all over the place. And these power grids might stay down, you know, heaven forbid, as long as when Maria hit Puerto Rico. And so, you know, and there's even been National Geographic's, you know, documentaries about when the lights go out and stuff like that, which, of course, I own a copy of because I love apocalyptic movies. They're my favorite thing to watch most of the time. Apocalyptic movies and alien movies are like my two favorite things to watch, you know, and of course Christmas movies at Christmas time, but you know, but that's all right. But I like the apocalyptic alien movies because really they're talking about the same thing, just different portions of the apocalyptic period, you know, and there's so many of them that are prophetic. And I love that the Lord showed me, Eyes of Darkness and Edge of Darkness being directly related to one another, essentially. You know, that everybody knows about the, by now, the Dean Koontz book that was revised in 1987 or whatnot, that talked about the Wuhan 400 bioweapon lab, you know, a pandemic that was released. You know, and this stuff is not accidental. These things are highly prophetic. Our fingerprint of God is everywhere. Our Father wants us to know these things. People are going to whistleblow. And where are they going to whistleblow to? They're going to whistleblow to a fiction author, you know, clandestinely, or else it's going to be, they're going to whistleblow to an editor that can go in and make an edit in a revised version, like is what happened with the Wuhan. But imagine the Eyes of Darkness and the Edge of Darkness. I mean, you know, come on, a movie entitled The Edge of Darkness, where, you know, a woman is like killed by the black ops for having a job in a lab that's like, you know, stealing foreign nuclear parts and foreign nuclear design documents so they can create false flag nukes and use them in the United States against the United States population. Are you kidding me? I mean, please. Eyes of Darkness, Edge of Darkness, Eyes of Darkness, Edge of Darkness. If your life's not supernatural, it's superficial. Can't, you know, and it's just, if I could just get over the frying pan things with a little bit more grace, but I got to figure out how after, like, you know, right about there, I'm like, oh, this can't be happening again. And then, oh, you know, oh, holy moly. And then it's like, and then once you get about three or four more of these, and then a rock comes and smashes it right in the forehead, you know, I've got to learn to get up, walk into my prayer chair in my little prayer closet area, turn off all the lights, close my eyes, and focus on Jesus. I have got to teach myself to do that. I have to teach myself to do that because I don't. I don't do that enough. I do it occasionally, and sometimes I kind of give myself a little holy pat in the head, but most of the time I get punched out enough of times and it gets to me, and I got to get past that. I think we all have to get past that. I think we're coming to a time without, beyond any shadow of a doubt, things are going to get worse. Is anybody out there seeing – okay, please. Is anybody out there seeing this, like, series of claimed prophecies, supposedly from multiple ones, claiming that Hillary Clinton's going to get elected as president this fall? Has anybody been seeing any of those out there? Let's do something fun, shall we? Let's all take our printers. We all have a little printer, a little inkjet printer. This will be fun. This is a nice little exercise in we'll call it Prophecy 101 stuff, right? Because I've got over 1,300 pages of Word documents with prophecies in them. And I'm like, you know, I go through that sometimes and I'm like going, oh, yeah? But anyway, wouldn't it be interesting, just as an exercise, let's take one of those. Hillary's coming back to become the president this fall. Okay, let's take one of those prophecies and just print it out on your inkjet printer, and just grab yourself a little push pin, and wherever your desk is in a house, whatever, just push it right there in the wall, right there beside you. And maybe put a big old, you know, red mark to call it out or whatever the case is. But I've done this before. I've had people that I considered to be absolutely A-list prophets over the years, and they prophesied so strongly on the imminence of, you know, I mean, even to the point of don't even leave your house kind of thing. I got emails. It's like, I got to go to work. I'm not sure if I should even go to work because so-and-so said the blankety blank. And I'm like, brother, just please go to work, okay? I get emails from like 19-year-old kids that love the Lord, and they're like, I don't know if I should go to college. I gotta, I'm enlisted to go, and I'm supposed to start this fall. And what should I do, Johnny? Should I go to college? It's the end of the world. I'm like, man, dude, totally go to college, you know, because I mean, here's the thing. So print out one of those, and just, you know, whenever you see one that's like, come on, really, really, just grab it and just stick it on a clipboard so you can flip past it and remind yourself. In April of 2017, I literally hung up a calendar because I was getting suspicious. You know, I was starting to get suspicious because there was way too many of them coming out and saying, this is it. It's happening right now. You don't have any time. It's all over. The Ark door has closed. Bum, bum, bum. There's no closed Ark doors. I mean, and I would go over the calendar. It was the first week of April of 2017. I'm not going to name two prophets. I won't name them, but there's two of them very well known, very well known. And they both, on that same week, it was totally like big eyes. Oh, no. And I thought to myself, you know what? I'm not going to let this one slip by. I grabbed myself a big old red Sharpie marker. And I walked right over and I marked it real big and bold. Because I wanted to look at it all month long and just wait and see. Nothing happened. Now we're in 2020, and the first really prophetic Olivet Discourse global scope event in the history of the world has finally happened. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. That's a wonderful thing. Now, for you people that are in the militia-filled states that are, or in California or Oregon or Washington or Pennsylvania, can you imagine that? Pennsylvania, one of the top five states for lockdown right now. Yeah, I talk to my relatives up there all the time. They're not too very happy about it. I wouldn't be. I'd be flipping out. I can't stand being in a house more than maybe 1 week. I have to have like at least one day of the weekend that I get out in the sun, go somewhere and listen to some Jimmy Buffett music or something, and, you know, and just get out, praise God, or have some, you know, strange, you know, gelatinous, you know, unusual Tex-Mex concoction brought to my table, which are usually pretty incredibly delicious. But anyway, here we are, and we're really just waiting for the rest of the country to open up. It's all in process. We got to see whether or not the supply chains reopen normally, or if there's going to be burps in the supply chains that need, supply chainists interruptus and some kind of an injection of cash, or who knows, because after all, all we got to do is just walk over to our computer and say, let me just add another $6 trillion. How many zeros is that? How many zeros is 6 trillion? Okay, good. The budget's back in good shape again. We can give people money, and we can have people working for free from home for the next 5 years right now. I just stuck another, let's just, here we go. Maybe I'll add a couple more zeros. So the money system is so incredibly fake. We all know that. It's been that way for years. That's why I'm always kind of like thinking to myself, man, you know, people will send me these things, you know, they're listening to the, you know, these guys that are like, you know, the, you know, they're the bomb. They're like, they're the financial, you know, that they're the Gerald Celente, of the universe, these guys. And they're out there, you know, from the Trends Institute, and he's been wrong like so many times. It's unbelievable. But anyway, but I used to listen to Gerald Celente all the time back in the early days of Alex Jones, back in 2002, 2003, 2004, when I was, you know, around about that time. I have every single Alex Jones DVD. I buy DVDs and documentaries and stuff like crazy, and I take notes and books, and I'm crazy. I go crazy over, you know, trying to be smart as I possibly can, figure out how to be, by, you know, studying all this different stuff. It's always, I always kind of get a little smile on my face when somebody sends me a YouTube video like, brother, you got to see this. And I'm like thinking to myself, okay. And I'm always going to be gracious. I'm like, oh, thank you. God bless you. You know, and I'm thinking to myself, I saw that back in 2007. You know, but there are people that are waking up, and this is a good thing. Praise God, this is a good thing. And what's really cool is to realize that this is happening. Our Father is so merciful that it's happening early enough that it's giving us an opportunity to make some adjustments in our lives. And I'm suspecting that these jagged boulders that have been bashing me upside the head lately are letting me know I'm going to get some, well, I might have some stuff happen to me that I need to be, let's just say, far better prepared for, if you know what I mean.
You are on the red list. Come out.
Are you
up.
Serious? Are you serious? Whoa!
Attention. Tony Duncan. You are on the red list. Come out. Put your hands up.
This is wrong. Wrong. This is disturbing.
Wait a minute. I might have to digress. Maybe those prophecies are true. Because, well, the red phone is lighting up and it's line 3. Could this be her?
Fox mo baxikaba. Edge chivotne chivunte.
It's just wrong. Wrong. This is disturbing.
Well, listening through my teletype driven, it's a text conversion, universal, international, it's a multiverse. And it works across multiple universes, trillions of life forms, many different parsecs of the universe, tens of thousands, if not millions of different galaxies and civilizations of different kinds of creepy beings from gosh knows where. And I'm pretty sure that my multiversal translator said, I think that was Hillary, I'm not sure, but I think it was, that she intends to get reelected this fall. Could it be?
Human sacrifice, dogs and cats living together, mass hysteria.
Yeah, that's what it would be, all right. Oh, man. Man, oh, man, oh, man, oh, man, oh, man, oh, man, oh, man. I can try. Oh, boy, can you imagine? I'm pretty sure about that point I would figure out how to liquidate everything I can, find the most remote island around Bora Bora with banana trees. I would have to work out a lot, though. I really have to build up my upper body strength, because shimmying up a banana tree to get a banana, that is some seriously hard work. Unless maybe they make like a really long super telescoping banana picker. If I could take one of those to like an island in Bora Bora and do kind of like that, that movie Castaway kind of thing. And I'd even take my little Wilson ball with me. I got one of those Wilson balls. I was like, when I was in a sports authority, I'm like, no way, it's Wilson. It's actual Wilson, all with the holy imprint on and everything. I had to have one. He's like my best friend, you know, because I don't have any friends. I scare everybody away. Even when I make friends with people, I'm like thinking, hey, this person could be a pretty cool friend of mine. You know, and I'm like thinking to myself, wow, man, finally somebody I could go out and, you know, have a, you know, enjoy a nice day out by the water or whatever, just get out of the house or ride bike with. And every time I think I have a friend, then I'm like, you know, I scare them away. you know, whether it be over the telephone or whatever. I guess I just, you know, scare them away. I gave up on trying to meet somebody to be. I just want people to be my friend. You can't even find. You can't even join. There is no such thing, you know, on the internet as like friends are us. You know what I'm saying? It's like, you know, all the different, you know, dating sites are geared toward, you know, that kind of stuff. And I'm not interested in that kind of stuff. I need a Friends R Us. Just hang out. That's what they ought to call it. Just hang out, .com. And, you know, I could get on there and, you know, but I'd probably scare them away too. They'd be like, oh no, this can't be really happening. Who is this nutbag? The whole world's coming to an end. Look out, make a run for it. And then I'd be sitting there by myself with my, well, I mean, whatever, with my very cool tropical, coconut crusted onion ring stack. praise God. And my mango chutney infused onion. Yeah, you got to use the infused word because it sounds like, can you see him? It almost makes it seem like the chefs are back there infusing. They're like sitting there with these like hypodermic needles going, like Bill Gates going, hey, Fauci, come here. Let's put some more luciferase into this chutney here. We're going to infuse it. Can you believe it? This is some weird stuff we got going on in this world right now. ID 2020, make a run for it. Holy mackerel. It's unbelievable. Kids, you ready? Have you been patient enough or what? No, you kids. Okay, here we go. Kids, did you hear about the new brooms? Did you hear about the new broom? The new broom. Well, it's sweeping the nation. You know, kind of a little bit of marketing there, kids. What do you think about that? Come on. You can work with me here. What? Okay. All right. That was a little corny. Corny. I never liked that term corny. It always made me think I needed to get like a Dr. Scholl's thing going on or something. That's a corny joke. I'm like, Dr. Scholl's, I'm just not connecting the dots here. It's not making me laugh. All right. Anyway, the next one up here. The next one. Kids, you ready? Did you hear about the party a little boy had for his sister's Barbie dolls? It was a barbecue. Kids, what do you think? Come on, a barbecue. Oh, okay. All right. Barbecue. Makes me hungry. But you can't eat those. Plastic and all that. It's just nasty. And your hair gets stuck in between your teeth. I'm kidding. I don't know anything about that. Do I? Kids, I don't know nothing about eating Barbie heads or whatever. I'd never do that. But haven't we all tried dog biscuits? Come on. Admit it. Don't even be playing here. Admit it. When you were 3 or 4 years old, maybe 5, you got underneath the shelf and you tried a dog biscuit, didn't you? Admit it. Kids, have you ever tried a dog biscuit? That's right. They taste horrible. How can an animal that supposedly has 20 times better smelling capabilities than a human eat a dog biscuit? And I won't even get going on some of these really weird dogs that eat things that are like, you know, if you know what I mean. I'm like, don't be telling me nothing about you being able to smell diddly if you're eating that. Right, kids? It's unbelievable. All right, praise God. All right, let's see here. Hey, kids, how does a suit put his child to bed? How does a suit put his child in the bed? He tucks him in it. You know, like a tux. Come on, kids. It's working me here. A lot of booing. All right. Praise God. And on that note, let's go ahead and enter into the ever so much jolly and fun news.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please?
It's not normal.
It's just wrong.
Game over.
I praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I still, I'm just blown away how the Lord shows me one right after the other sometimes. It's literally like, it's just amazing. These prophetic movies, V for Vendetta. Like if you stand a little bit of blood, a little bit of swordsmanship and stuff, some people can't, and that's fine. But boy, oh boy, about a pandemic that was released in 2020 that jettisoned the world into a dystopian, Orwellian, evil control grid. They even said the guy that was ruling the world, the Obama-esque Antichrist-like individual, was like, and that those Americans were destroyed because of their sin and they didn't handle it properly. I'm like, man, I can't believe I'm seeing this on a movie. It's like, this can't be happening. No. No. Anyway, all right, let's go ahead and I was going to go ahead and play this big old long Hannity thing there where he's talking about reopening America and what a great job that DeSantis is doing in Florida, and couldn't everybody else be like DeSantis from day one? We would have been completely open by now. We wouldn't have lost all our vegetables and the stuff that in the restaurants, and the people wouldn't be losing their houses and all the horrible things that are happening to the economy and the global – and it's not just the – our economy, it's a global economy. I mean, you know, you know, it doesn't matter what you're making, whatever the widget is that you're manufacturing, there are parts that are coming from different parts of the world. Now, anyway, so, you know, those supply chains. So guess what happens to the people over in Bangladesh that are putting together your XYZ Bob, you know, for you may be selling 10,000 of these gizmos a week. All right. But your XYZ Bob is made in Bangladesh. And those people are finally able to feed their families and live a relatively normal life because they're living at the XYB. They're living in that little town, by that little building that is making these XYZ bobs for you know, your widget over in America. And when that gets shut down, those people, you think your situation is bad? You're talking about these people are starving to death. Our eyesight is so myopic and tunnel visionish. We have such, unfortunately, woefully inadequate understandings of things, particularly from the viewpoint of the throne room of God. If we can't see things from the throne room of God, if we can't see things and imagine ourselves listening to the conversations going on between Jesus and the Congress, you know, and our Father, you know, in 1 Kings 22:19, where it talks about the spirits, you know, and King Ahab and Ramoth Gilead and all that, you know, that stuff goes on all the time. You can believe it. And you know, we need to be able to be in combat information center. We need to be able to be standing there in the combat information center, in the throne room of God, listen to them talk and go, look at this. Look at what's happening over here. Well, if we do this, well, yeah, okay, what if the devil does this? Okay, well, let's do a little bit of cat and mouse with the devil. Let's send him over this way. We're going to distract him. We're going to do something else over here. But when you're able to see things from that viewpoint, it changes your perspective on a lot of things in a big, big way. And then you really begin to start realizing how seething evil the darkness actually is, because they are either what's the word? Maybe their mental acuity. I want to say this with the nicest, kindest, most politicalness, correctnessness. But their mental acuity or their intellectual acuity is so hampered. They're 20 sandwiches short of a picnic basket. It's unbelievable the stuff that these people are doing out there. It's like with complete blinders on, without any realization of how they're destroying not just the lives of the people in their own states, but they're destroying the lives of people in other countries. Hundreds, thousands of them, children not eating. This is all because of these. Okay, whatever. I don't know. Sometimes I just get a little worked up over some of these things, but you know.
You're good. Thanks, Captain Obvious. I was on a totally different track.
All right, back to the news.
Freaking!
President Trump says he is correcting injustice by making the houses of worship essential and will override the governors. Wow, this is going to be interesting. I don't think you're going to like that. I can see right now, the governor of California going, we're going to call out the National Guard. And they got the National Guard standing there by their tanks and all dressed up in their riot gear and everything like that. And then Trump sends in, NORTHCOM troops from NORTHCOM out of Denver. And they're on the opposite side of the streets. And so we got military guys, U.S. military on the left and U.S. military on the right. And one of them's working for the local governor and the other one's working for Trump. And they're just having a standoff and throwing bombs and tear gas at each other. This is going to be weird. We're going to need to keep our eyes open. Some strange things, some scary stuff might happen. Who knows? All right, praise God. Listen to this. Next headline up. Hallelujah. Christian News announces France ordered by their top court to lift a halt on indoor church services. So even in France, this is a reprint from an article from the Christian Institute. So this trend is actually a pretty cool trend that is happening lots of different places. And, if it was in France makes one, Marcon comes out and says, churches are open and nobody gives them any hard time. It's not here. You'll have militias marching through the streets, people. This is going to be, as this stuff starts to unravel, folks, let's just thank our lucky stars. No, let's just praise Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father, for not letting this be a massive Carrington event where the power grid goes down for like 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 weeks at a time. Thank you, Father, for weaning us little by little and helping us understand where our weaknesses are so we can draw in closer to you, Father, and get ourselves the things that we need to get. Got to have that. Well, you got to have certain things. All right. Next one up. Hallelujah. The Hill. Listen to this. Two Southern churches forced to reclose. They had to reclose their churches. Those evil people down in the South, Southern Baptist and all them. I don't know who they are. But anyway, it says two Southern churches forced to reclose after leaders and congregants get the coronavirus. Oh, no. Well, what's that all about? How do we know that they even got the coronavirus? Maybe they just got a cold. Maybe they just got the regular flu. At what point does somebody say, oh, I got the coronavirus? Now, there are certain symptoms that are undeniable, but it's just with all the hysteria. And don't even get me going on all the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of doctors that are forming unions and writing letters to the president explaining this is insane. And even Fauci, that evil person, he has even come out and he has retracted and he said, well, I really didn't mean for you to lock down that long. I'm like, well, somebody please place him under arrest and then just, maybe, I don't know, get a really powerful 50 million volt stun gun and just, No, vengeance is the Lord's. Oh, boy. Anyway, next one up. Hallelujah. Jordan warns Israel of massive conflict over annexation. And, and this has been going on for a while. This King Abdullah II dude, he gets all kinds of sparky. He doesn't like the annexation thing, which basically, what is the annexation thing? So basically all that is you take the areas that Israel has essentially put buildings and apartments and condominiums and built little communities and all that kind of stuff. You take the areas that Israel has historically inhabited, right? And then you say, that area over there looks really, really nice to build. And we know it's kind of contested and some people think that it belongs to them, but we know that it doesn't really belong to them and all that kind of stuff. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to start building condos on it. We're going to build like communities and put up stores and churches and everybody. We're going to let people move there. We're going to expand our area. This is our land. The problem is that's what the term annexation is. The annexation basically says, hey, we see that land over there and we're going to develop it. They annex it. Okay, whatever. All right. And then you've got these guys like this King Abdullah II dude who's like all kind of fired up and gets all kinds of, you know, this is the blah, 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 and that kind of thing, you know. So again, it's not just that. It's Iran and it's, you know, the Syrian contribution to the Iran problem. And the list just goes on and on. Lebanon. And don't even get me going on the Palestinians that are actually living in Israel. They're throwing rocks and all kinds of stuff. So, you know, so anyway, we shall continue to keep our eyes on that. Also, watch out for all the new vaccine is the mark of the beast. There's billions of those out there now, folks. I predicted it a long time ago. I knew that's what was going to happen. After all, the American Express card was the mark of the beast in 1970, or so, you know, in the early 70s or late 60s. And you know what? I believe it. I refused to take that American Express card when they gave it to me. No, because it was the mark of the beast. Everybody said so, right? Look, I'm not saying I'm going to sign up for a vaccine. I don't want anybody sticking any of that creepy weirdness in my arm, all right? But but telling everybody it's like, oh, it's just crazy. Okay, you know, nobody's reading their Bible. I put up on the article, tribulation-now.org. I put in the article. It's entitled DBDBDBDB. Let me see if I can find it here. Hold on a second. Yeah, COVID-19 warnings and a mark of the beast. I actually injected a whole section on the mark of the beast in that, you know, with quotes and colored text and everything to call it out right from the Bible so people can read it and see and know and get it, hopefully. Although I do know there are some folks that read stuff and they still don't get it, but that's okay. That's what we're all part of the body. We got to help each other out. And if they don't want to believe it, that's okay. It's okay. I'm holding on to hope, and I do not believe we have come to the point of V for Vendetta. I don't think we're there yet. I think we got way too much ahead of us. I think it was South Dakota just made an announcement that nobody will be asked to take a vaccine. Can you believe that? Yep. And then it said in the article, it said, well, I guess there'll be mass migrations to the state of South Dakota. South Dakota, you know, they'll have like the largest tax base ever. It'll turn into the next Las Vegas. You know, it's like, oh, hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. And on and on and on she goes where she stops. Well, what is it? Revelation 22:19? I don't know. But anyway, praise Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's move on. Big Shots purchasing luxury bunker with shooting ranges for fear of corona cause criminality surge. And they mean it. And they actually give examples of how people are building bunkers and they have shooting ranges in them, of course, because they have to shoot the zombie people. The zombie people that are knocking on their door going, I have corona. I'm going to eat your head off. You know, this is unbelievable stuff going on today. Oh, it could have been so much worse, folks. We should just be praising Jesus. We should be in tears and praise. What a great warning shot over the bow. I know it's an annoyance. I get it. I would not like to be in a state that's locked down more than, you know, the inconveniences that are here. But yeah, the places that are heavily locked down, that is wrong on like so many levels. It's unbelievable. And my heart goes out to you. I'm flabbergasted. I it's a good thing I'm not president because I probably would have called up the troops from NORTHCOM. Probably sent them right into – I've had the entire Pacific Northwest completely being run by NORTHCOM troops right now. I'd oust like all the governors. Michigan would be out. People would be jumping in for joy in the streets. Yay! President Johnny Baptist. Oh, whatever. Praise God. If you don't smile about this stuff, you know what you'll do. You'll get all depressed. You'll close your door. You'll go into your prayer closet, and you won't leave. The whole, Memorial Day weekend or whatever will go by, and you'll be just like sitting there going, don't talk to me. And then you realize there's nobody out there trying to talk to you in the first place. That's the scariest part. All right. Anyway, next up. Hallelujah. Trump, call Obama to testify. He knew everything. I just don't see that happening. I know they're trying to get him to testify about all this stuff, you know, unmasking. Oh, no, he took off his COVID-19 V for Vendetta mask. unmasking, you know. All right, praise God. Next up, hallelujah. Santa Ana PhD, robberies increased by 50%. Suspects using face covering orders to take advantage and rob stores.
You're good. Thanks, Captain Obvious. I was on a totally different track.
Oh. Kim Jong-un calls for stronger nuclear war deterrent, vows to put strategic forces on high alert. Oh, no, it's Kim Jong-un. He's going to blow that evil whistle at 3 o'clock in the morning and scare all of us South Koreans. I wonder if they have any of those kinds of funky-sounding sirens down here in Florida. I know they have them in the Midwest, you know, Tornado Alley and all that. I've heard them. Those are creepy. That's a really creepy feeling when you're in, like, Kansas and you're sitting in, like, a room up in a building. And then all of a sudden, everything gets quiet. Everything gets really quiet. The leaves stop blowing. The trees don't rustle. There's no movement of leaves. All birds completely silent. No tweeting. Everything is quiet. It is very apocalyptic. And you look out the window and you're like, what's going on? And somebody in the room goes, there's a tornado coming. And then all of a sudden, you hear this. And let me tell you something. For good reason, they take that very very seriously. Because when everything stops, when all motion stops, all bird tweeting stops, everything completely, completely stops. And you have this eerie silence. That darn thing is close by. Dangerously close by. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. All right, next up on the news. So Kim Jong-un calls for stronger nuclear war deterrent, vows to put strategic forces on high alert. Another one, Senegal eases COVID-19 restrictions as the food crisis looms, with over 130 million people facing starvation, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, it's like, starve them first, you know. Check Sweden now. You know, as a matter of fact, Florida has similar numbers to Sweden. I mean, as far as proportionalities are concerned and things like that. The states didn't close all the way down like Florida. It's like nothing's wrong. Everything's the same. The only thing that's kind of annoying is, you know, the waiters and waitresses are wearing masks. But they're doing it, you know, for their, you know, so they don't scare the scared people. Because there's lots of those. All right. Because that's what you want to do. We all want to be scared to death. Oh, no. Oh, no. It's the end of the world. And, you know, we're going to have to learn not to be. We're going to have to learn to trust our Father all the time. Even when our prayers aren't being answered. Wow. Praise God. Next up. United States tech behemoths like Google and Apple are reportedly cooperating with Chinese surveillance firms. And I'm like, once again.
You're good. Thanks, Captain Obvious. I was on a totally different track.
Another headline. United States threatens Venezuela. This is according to Sputnik News out of Russia. And you can't trust any of them. But what you do is you correlate all of the information from multiple news sources. When that all lines up and they're all saying the same thing, essentially, with some twists, then you can validate it. But anyway, or if there's, you know, imagery or whatever captured from an incident, you know, over Twitter, you know, you can see it actually happening. But this is interesting. It's claiming that the United States is threatening Venezuela-bound Iranian tankers with imminent use of military force. Huh. Another headline, strange activity detected on heavily patrolled road leading to Kim Jong-un's villa. Now, why is that weird? Well, it's because that's the kind of thing that our, you know, intelligence agencies keep close eyes on, not just ours, but other ones too. And they know the patrol routes. They know that at exactly 7:05 a.m. every single morning, a red truck goes driving down the road with two military guards in it, you know, and they know. For some reason, nobody knows why, there's like tons of extra military protections and guards and things going up and down his private road to his villa. And they find that highly suspicious. Another headline, praise God. Very abnormal seismic activity concerns scientists in South Korea. Now, this is a very noteworthy article here because, first off, South Korea doesn't really happen there very often. And it says, and this particular pattern that they're studying is very indicative of a major quake. So they're raising a big concern over this. But then again, all of California and Oregon and all that's a big concern there too, and has been for quite some time. Could be tonight. We don't know. All right. That'll make Terri Hill's talking on the show a little shaky. You know, pun intended, right? Amen. Another one. I have never seen such a cyclone in my life. It seemed like it was the end of the world. All I could do was pray. As the death toll reached over 100 for a super cyclonic storm, Amphon, that hit India and Bangladesh. I always find that fascinating when they say, all I could do was pray. I'm like, Pops, put down the sandbag and pray now. You know, it's like you got it backwards, man. I've done everything. I've been working on this problem for over 6 weeks straight. Then I decided, I guess I'll just pray. I'm like, did it ever occur to you that none of those things would have happened in the first place if you had a relationship with your father that was proactive? That's not to say you're not going to go through hard times because, you know, don't allow it to bother you, brothers and sisters, concerning the fiery trial that is to try you, as if some strange thing has happened to you. But rejoice. Right? That's our walk. Thank you, Lord. May I have another? Over 600 doctors have sent a letter to Trump urging to get rid of lockdowns. Calling it a, they actually use this term, these doctors, they call the overall response to this whole COVID nonsense. I mean, I wouldn't want anybody to get sick from it. Okay. It's a very bad version of the flu with a crushing upper respiratory symptom. And it lingers. I wouldn't wish it on anybody. But I'm just saying, these 600 doctors are saying that the true mass casualty incident is not the virus itself. It's the destruction of people's lives and the improper overreacting in the lockdowns, the overuses of masks. And they're all herd mentality doctors. They're all saying that's how the body adjusts and creates its own, you know, defenses. Alan Dershowitz, WND-TV, Alan Dershowitz says that the states in the United States of Babylon the Great have a legal right over and above the Constitution, claims it's in the 10th Amendment to forcibly vaccinate every citizen to curb spread of disease. What do you know? I don't know, folks. What do you think? What are you going to do? What are you going to do? That must be my vax. Whoa. Boy, they're awful demanding down there. I can see them on the security camera. Holy moly. Oh, just pretend we're not here. That'll work every time. They're not that smart. All right. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And on that note, let's go ahead and bring on Sister Terri. Praise God. Here we go. Sister Terri, are you there?
I sure am, John.
Good. Good. Praise God. Glad to have you. Love it when you come on the show. Very inspiring, edifying, and, you know, sometimes even motivational in a good way, because we all need, you know, to get shoved, you know, and we don't want to be complacent. So it's always a blessing to have you join us. Thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Well, thank you for so much for having me. I look forward to being with you tonight.
How you doing out there? How you doing out there in California? They throwing rocks
well,
at you when
I'm
you
telling you. Out the oh, my, my. learning to be flexible, put it that way.
Oh, man. Yeah, the stuff you hear, and it's kind of hard to believe. They've really got, I don't know, it's, oh, well. I feel sorry for you guys. I do. Oh, well. All right, hopefully it'll loosen up a little bit here pretty quickly. All right, but anyway, praise God. I'm going to go ahead and grab my little virtual folding chair and, you know, let you go ahead and take the whole ball and just run with it and take it in for a TD. Praise Jesus. And this is the second part of Tribulation and Travail. The first part and the second part, study notes that Sister Terri puts together are available on tribulation-now.org. And all you got to do is go to the links. If it's a mobile device, they're at the very, very bottom of your, you know, swirl all the way down. The links are at the bottom. It's white on black. And if it's a website, it's just over on the left. And very close to the top, it just says Terri Hill. And both the last teaching and tonight's are right side by side there on that page. Praise God. So on that note, thank you, Terri.
Well, thank you again, John, for having me. And such an honor to be with you all, and a joy for me to be able to share with my brothers and sisters who are on the same page and just wanting to hear from Jesus. So let's open with prayer if we could. Father, I just thank you and praise you for this opportunity. I thank you for your people. I thank you, Father, for my little part. I ask that you would take that which you have given to me and make it life to your people, Lord God. Let it encourage, exhort, build up, and strengthen and edify, Father. That truly is what I want to do. And hide me in that secret place, Lord God. Let everything that is said and done be bring glory and honor to you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Before I get started, I just wanted to share with you, any of you that would like to contact me for prayer, if you would like me to mail handouts to you, my website address is awordindueseason.com. I'd be happy to hear from you, and it's an honor to pray for you. So just wanted to let you know your sister is here, and again, we're here just to encourage you and to pray for you. Now, one of the things my friends who know me know that I am very transparent. And so for those of you that may be listening outside of the mainland United States, living here in California has been an adventure, let me tell you. One of the things is I just sit with the Lord every morning and have my time with him, and I meet with him early, and I'm up before the others are up, and I just ask him, what is your heart, Jesus? Is there anything you want to share with me? I just try to listen. I'm studying. I'm going over ideas and thoughts that I put down on paper. And so these handouts that I've prepared with you are what I've been led to read and to write down. So, again, I'm so happy to send those to you if you want them. And, again, understanding that these wake-up calls that are coming and the frustration that our Father does allow to come into our lives can be used one of two ways. We can become angry and think that our rights are being violated, or we can understand that there's a Father in heaven who sits above it all, whose Son was absolutely victorious, who has triumphed over all the powers of darkness, who has given us the keys of the kingdom, who has told us that we've been seated together with Christ. Again, we have a choice on how we conduct ourselves and how we think when we're faced with challenges. And one of the things that has been impressed upon my heart, and again, it seems to be saturating the news, and we're so tired of hearing about it, is this virus called COVID-19. But what I've been hearing from my father as I sit with him is he's more concerned about the spiritual virus that has penetrated his church and is still there. And he calls it the spirit of Laodicea. And as I sit with him and I listen, all I can do is present myself every day. Father, I know I need to change. I know that I need the mind of Christ. I know that I need to see from your perspective. I ask you to teach me your ways. I ask that you would help me to hear from heaven. I understand that there is a council that meets with the Father. There is the council of the Lord. There is a place in Christ. And even what Jesus said, too, he said that, that there was a point in time that he opened their minds and their understanding that they could understand the scripture. So just sharing with you really honestly and saying, Father, what is it that you want to say? What is your perspective? Because I'm absolutely sick and tired of listening to the news. I'm absolutely sick and tired of the whining and the complaining. And I understand that there are issues of rights, and I understand all of that. But I guess it's because a part of my assignment from the Lord is to help prepare the body of Christ for the Lord's appearing. And again, it doesn't mean that I don't share or talk to people who are lost, because I do. But my concern is the conversation that I'm hearing coming from brothers and sisters who are in Christ, and what is coming out of their mouths. I flat out have some people upset with me because I sent them something the Father had given me. It's called Where Is Your Allegiance? And in fact, Tribulation Now ran that article. I think John had that up on his website for a time. But the anger seems to be toward the state, toward their lack of rights, anger about this, angry about that, the right to assemble. You know, first of all, I want to say that our brothers and sisters in China and other places around the world continue to meet in underground churches, and I am still impressed that the bride will be going underground, that the persecution is going to be increasing greatly in the nation that I live in, which is America, and brothers and sisters right now are suffering everywhere for their faith in Christ. They, in private, they risk their lives to do it. And all I can say is there is no law that can be passed. There is no tyrannical legislation that is going to dictate to the bride of Christ whether or not she can meet, whether or not she can pray, because we ought to obey God rather than man. Isn't that what God's word says? So if we can look beyond the inconvenience of where we're at now, and as I heard the Father say, he's more concerned about a spiritual virus that has penetrated his church. This is a great concern of his. And so when we deal with the reality of where we're at with this whole COVID-19 thing and understanding that this is just a wake-up call, friends, this is just the beginning, I believe, of sorrows. It is my humble opinion that it's just the beginning of sorrows and beginning of birth pangs. We've got a long way to go. I think Brother John touched on that earlier. I'm so glad he said that. Because as I read my Bible and as I line up the Word of God in the old and the new, we look at the symmetry of Scripture, we look at the patterns of Scripture, we understand, at least where we live here, I know that calamities may be unfolding. Crisis will come to us personally. Crisis and calamities will come to a nation. But I don't believe we've seen anything yet. And I said all that to say this. I don't believe those four horsemen are running like they will be. And let me just comment a little bit on that. I want to talk, first of all, and give you some understanding about the word tribulation, because Jesus made it clear in John 16:33, he said, "These things I've spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." Acts 14:22 says that they confirmed the souls of the disciples and exhorted them to continue in the faith, and that we must, through much tribulation, enter into the kingdom. Romans 8 tells us, who can separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, distress, persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. So tribulation, that Greek word for tribulation, means pressure, affliction, anguish, persecution, and trouble. Jesus said we're going to have it. We're told in the book of Romans to be patient in tribulation. 1 Thessalonians 3:4, Paul says to the church at Thessalonica, we told you that we would suffer tribulation. Now, many of us are suffering inconveniences. There are some, and I'm very much aware, may have lost their jobs, their source of income. If you live in the Midwest and other places where there have been horrendous storms that have come through, perhaps damage to your property or loss of a loved one through this COVID-19 situation, or just living life, beloved, pressure, crisis, and tribulation are a part of our life. I guarantee it. It's what the Word of God tells us. But what I want to point out to you and help to emphasize that Jesus is reminding us, because we're hearing a lot of clamor out here in Southern California about the right to assemble, and I've known others that actually have been picketing, and the Lord is reminding me that it was never the assignment of his son nor of the early church to fix Babylon. They were not assigned to try to fix the disruptions of the civil world at that time, but that's another message for another time, I guess. But let me just say this. Religion will dictate three things. Now, I'm talking about a relationship with Jesus Christ. This is different, because a religious person will be told and believes that religion dictates three things: where, when, and how to worship. But Jesus said the opposite. He said, when he spoke to the woman about a woman at the well about religion and worship, he reminded her in John chapter 4, those that worship the Father will worship him in spirit and in truth. So true worship is not related to a location, okay? True worship is a cry of the heart. It is a lifestyle. And this is an opportunity for the Lord's people now to begin to allow him to search our hearts and for us to ask him to set our priorities into order. One of the concerns that I've had is with people that I talk to is they're missing their social club. They are missing their church picnics. And I understand there is a place for picnics and for fellowship. I get that. And I do that. But they're upset because they can't get back to the routine of things. But my experience and what I'm hearing is a great concern, because they're missing their social interaction, and because of their frustration of what they think they can't do and where they can't go, I see the enemy has come in and has brought in a dissatisfaction, when in fact I believe the Father is allowing these kinds of things to come so that we can get alone with him, so our priorities can come into order, so our homes can come into order, so that husbands and wives can pray for one another, so that dads and moms can spend time with children, and so on and so forth. Now, let me just say that I continue to be burdened for the present state of churchianity, all right? I have been praying. One of the things I've been praying during this whole COVID-19 thing is that people who have been out of fellowship in the large congregations would be directed by the Spirit to go on to links that are preaching the full counsel of God and the message of the kingdom, the true message that will not only exhort and build up and edify and strengthen, but also pierce and bring conviction. You know, one day when Jesus preached and he ministered, they wanted to throw him over the cliff. The preaching of John the Baptist landed him in jail. I mean, the preaching of the cross, beloved, has never been popular, and it never will be. But the present condition of Laodicea and the way that it looks and what it is embracing, and the fact that in the Olivet Discourse in Matthew 24, one of the things that Jesus mentioned four times, first thing he mentioned, he talked about the level of deception at the end of the age prior to his appearing. So as tribulation comes, God is pleading with humanity. As crisis comes, the Father, first of all, is wanting to wake up his church. He's wanting his people to return to their first love, right? Jesus challenged the church at Ephesus. He said, I see your works, I see this, I see that, but you have left your first love. And so what I'm saying is Jesus wants his people to hear what he has to say, to hear what he has to say. In fact, seven times in chapters 2 and 3 of the book of Revelation, the emphasis is upon hearkening. In other words, he who has an ear to hear, let him hear. Clear to me, the Lord Jesus wants us to take the time to listen to him. And instead of trying to occupy ourselves with temporary things. Now, I understand we need to be refreshed. We need to get out. And we need to go on walks. And we go here and there. And I do. I'm out every day. My husband and I are out every day. And we need to be refreshed. But let me just say that this is an opportunity to be listening to what's on the Father's heart and what our next assignment will be in this new season that we're walking into, because clearly things have changed, beloved, and it's never going to be the same again. We're going to have opportunities for our character to be proven. We're going to have opportunities, evangelistic opportunities, to share the gospel with people. It's going to also strengthen the house church movement. I'm convinced that the early church and the pattern that we see in the opening chapters in the book of Acts, that the bride will be meeting again in the churches and going underground. I also, many parents who are involved with homeschooling movement, it's an opportunity for parents to really connect with the children. And so it's an opportunity. And again, we have to go to the Father and ask him, what is it, Lord, that you are showing me? Now, let me just say, when we talk about travail, we're talking about tribulation and travail. I want to read something to you in the book of Romans, chapter 8, starting at verse 19 and then 20 to 23. The word says, "For we know that all of creation is groaning and travailing in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, we are groaning within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body." And those of us who are looking to Jesus and understanding that we are just pilgrims passing through, that this world is not our home, that everything that we espouse as precious and holy and good, the enemy is absolutely hostile toward all that we hold dear. And Jesus said in John 16:21, he said, "A woman, when she's in travail, has sorrow because her hour is come. But as soon as she is delivered of the child, she remembers no more the anguish for joy that a man has been born into the world." So what's happening right now? The woman in travail is a picture of Christ being formed in the saints. And as we walk through crisis, as we walk through calamity, as we go through pressure or loss or even upheaval, for some people, this whole COVID-19 situation is bringing upheaval to their lives. For others, it may be an inconvenience. For others, they will suffer tremendous loss. And so different people are in different situations. So here we have Christ being formed in us. And we know that there are more calamities unfolding. Again, I'm going to say that we haven't seen anything yet. I think when we compare Matthew 24 with the first four seals of Revelation chapter 6. I want to talk just a little bit about that and hopefully bring some clarity here. Let's see if we could. The book of Revelation, and I just want to touch on a few things in Revelation 6, because Revelation 6, 1 to 14, I believe, marks the beginning of birth pangs with the first four seals. So in the breaking of the seals, when the Lamb breaks the seals on the scroll, and that's Revelation 6:1, when the first seal is broken, John was seeing and recording what he heard and saw, and he says, "One of the four living beings said with a voice like thunder, 'Come,' and I looked." And what John said, he saw a white horse, its rider carrying a bow and a crown on his head. Now, if we compare this scripture with Zechariah 6, 1 to 5, as we look at these horses, Zechariah actually helps to define what these horses are. These are spirits that have gone out from the presence of the Lord. So if you want to cross-reference that later, that's Zechariah 6, 1 to 5. We are seeing a picture here of deception. We are seeing what I believe is a picture of Antichrist dressed in white, again, knowing that the counterfeit one comes to make a 7-year peace treaty with the Jews. This is a picture of religious deception. The fact that he's carrying a bow and there is a crown on his head, again, I believe is an allusion to the fact that for a time, you know, Jesus called Satan the prince of the power of the air. He called him the prince of this world. But when we compare this first rider who's on a white horse, compare it with Revelation 19, 11 to 16, there's a clear, very clear distinction between the one who counterfeits the Lord Jesus Christ with the true King of Kings and the true Lord of Lords as described in Revelation 19. Now, he's carrying a bow and there is a crown on his head. Again, a crown is symbolic of one who has authority or a king, and scripture tells us also a reward. Now, the Antichrist spirit, and there are many Antichrists already at work. We know the Word of God tells us that. But this Antichrist mimics Jesus, who also returns on a white horse. And the fact that he's carrying a bow and the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords has a sword, I mean, there's a great distinction here. So we're looking at a different kind of authority here. He's only given authority for a period of time. And again, in the wake of religious deception, which is the Antichrist, the white horse, there will be the red horse, the black horse, and the pale horse that follow on the heels of that. And so with the breaking of those first four seals, when the second seal is broken, John records, the second living being said, "Come," and John saw a red horse, and that rider had a sword, and he took peace from the earth. So there was war and slaughter everywhere. So this is war and bloodshed. Now, we understand that there are pockets of dissension. There are wars in certain areas that never cease, that never stop. And we know that's a fact in the Middle East, different places throughout the world. There is war that comes and goes. But when the seal is broken, it will be a tremendous war. We haven't seen this unleashed yet. When the third seal is broken, the living being said, "Come," and John said he saw a black horse, and the rider had a pair of scales. And so we know that there's a picture of famine and food shortage. And by the time the fourth seal is broken, described in verses 7 and 8, the fourth living being said, "Come," and John saw a pale horse. Now, this color pale is actually yellow-green. It's a color of death. And his rider was named Death, and his companion was the grave. So by the time this fourth horseman completes his ride, one quarter of the earth's inhabitants will be dead, according to Revelation 6:8. So, beloved, as you can see, there is a lot of distress, death, and calamity yet to come. And once it starts, it could go very, very quickly. When we think about this COVID-19 situation, and I believe it does fall under the pestilence aspect and so on and so forth. But again, I don't think we've seen anything yet. And I'm not trying to sound repetitious, but I've asked the Father, "What is it you have to say?" He said, "Terri, it's the beginning of birth pangs. These are wake-up calls that I'm sending." And so as we watch events in the Middle East and the conflict there, Libya and Israel and nukes, there are going to be things of war that are going to affect every nation on the face of the earth. We know that the four severe judgments in Ezekiel 14, 21, the sword, the famine, the noisome beast, and the pestilence are already here. We understand that in some measure they're here. But we have a terrible financial collapse coming. We have chemical and biological attacks coming. An increase in disease, pestilence. There will be martial law, there will be increasing riots, there will be increasing earthquakes in intensity. And again, when Jesus likened the days prior to his coming, we know that he said, as it was in the days of Noah and as it was in the days of Lot, it would be a good thing for us to go back and review those scriptures. Clearly, Noah was a prepper. And those maybe a few years ago that mocked the preppers and said this is ridiculous, you're not having faith in God. Well, they need to read about the days of Noah that Jesus described in Matthew 24. Noah, like Enoch, walked with God. He was obedient. He was in fellowship with the Lord. The wickedness of man was great in the earth. He was a preacher of righteousness, and he found a way out through an open door 7 days prior to the flood. So when Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, he meant it. Now, also, as it was in the days of Lot, and you can see some similarities here. Lot was an official in the city of wickedness. We know that there was a point in time that Lot was with his uncle Abraham, but there was a dispute among the flocks. Lot chose to go down to Sodom because it reminded him of Egypt. This man was carnal. He moved according to the natural man. He was not in communion with God. In fact, twice Abraham came to help him. First of all, when he was captured by the king of Sodom, it was Abraham's sword that delivered Lot, and it will be the sword in the hands of God's people that will help to deliver our carnal brothers and sisters that are asleep and have fallen into carnality. He also then interceded in Lot's behalf at a later time when the Lord spoke to him. He said, I'm not going to hide from Abraham the thing that I'm about to do. And we know the whole situation when Abraham began to intercede for Lot. This is happening now. We have brothers and sisters in Christ. They are not hearing a message of preparing for the Lord's return. They are not hearing the wake-up calls. And as it was in the days of Lot, he was a lukewarm believer. He was attached to Egypt and the world in his heart. And Lot was snatched as a brand from the burning when the angels led him to safety just prior to the fire falling on Sodom. So Jesus is likening those days exactly to what things will be like prior to his coming. And again, the pain that we feel in our hearts toward our brothers and sisters in Christ who have been swept away by the world, again, entrenched in the values of the world, in that which Laodicea portrays, who are on this wide road, this all-inclusive, man-centered gospel, and it appeals to the masses. And it's these very large churches of thousands, I'm finding, the emergent church movement, where there's tolerance of all faiths, and we love everybody, come in, but there's no message of conviction. There's no true word of the Lord. There's no full counsel of God, and the people are not being prepared for what's coming. We're seeing that Laodicea, in fact, is a climate for the mark of the beast. Their spiritual state has got to change. So we have to be like Abraham and begin to pray for brothers and sisters who their lives are caught up in sports and entertainment, in their social clubs. And again, fellowship is important. I understand and I get the scripture, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. I get that. But beloved, it's time to sober up. It's time for us to understand that God is separating now, and he's more and more of these wake-up calls coming. The wise and the foolish virgins are separating. And there will be those that have the profession of faith. I mean, that many that have the lamps, they profess Christ. But the oil is not there, the oil being symbolic of readiness and of the Holy Spirit and the overflow of the Spirit. It would be like having a flashlight without batteries. I mean, you may have a nice-looking flashlight there and paid a lot of money, but if there are no good batteries on the inside, you're not going to see as it gets darker and darker. And this is a concern of mine. It is a concern that there's a spiritual decline, that people are being driven by self-will, by their carnal desires. And so their thinking in their mind is, how can I acquire more? How can I get what I want? How can I do what I want? It's an apostate condition right now, for the most part, across this United States of America. And I say that weeping. I say that because I'm seeing what I'm going to call false conversions. I have talked to people and others say, well, we had all these people come forward at the meeting and they said this sinner's prayer, but friends, after months and years, if there's no change, if there's no brokenness, if there's no true repentance, if there's no encounter with Christ, if there's no preaching of the cross, that's another gospel, and that's a real concern. the spirit of error has marked Laodicea. It's truth and it's error. There's a pastor in Southern California that is very well known, is a popular author. In fact, there's a couple of very large churches out here that are seeker friendly that I'm concerned for the state of the sheep that sit in these congregations, because one of them is saying that you can take the mark of the beast and still be saved. And he is also saying that the gifts are no longer valid. He's a cessationist. And there are others who the compromise is absolutely astounding. And they are setting the climate for the Antichrist as he comes in. In fact, they're going to be given over to be a part of the false prophet that precedes his unveiling. I'm absolutely convinced if the foolish virgins do not repent, they're going to be sucked up into this group that are going to welcome him and say he has the answers. He's going to restore prosperity. He's going to fix this. He's going to have the peace plan. Jesus wants us to have spiritual wealth, loved ones. It is not about possessions. These things can be lost overnight. The lukewarm church has lost its salt and light. They look like the world. They talk like the world. They party like the world. In conversations that I have with them, I'm finding more and more it's centering around worldly things, worldly attractions, and prayer and making disciples. You know, again, it's back to the Great Commission. Our assignment is the Great Commission. Preach the gospel to every creature. Make disciples. Lay hands on the sick. Cast out devils. Pray without ceasing. Feed the hungry. Clothe the naked. Take care of the widows. Take care of the orphans. Beloved, it's really simple. But what the enemy has done is coming in now and doing everything he can to erase that narrow road that Jesus said is the only way that leads to life. And he's trying to call more and more people into that wide road that leads to destruction in the name of love and peace. But we both know that the message of the cross has never been popular. It never will be popular, but it is the power of God to save. Glory to God. Another concern of mine, and so I'm calling out to teachers tonight, those of you who know how to make disciples, though, expound on the scriptures. We have to get the foundation laid in the lives of God's people. Hebrews 6, 1 and 2, we've got to teach them about repentance from dead works. There are many you would ask, what are dead works? They could not answer that. We have to teach them about true faith toward God, because faith will always require obedience. We have to teach them about the doctrine of baptisms. We have to help them to understand about the laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment. These, again, are the basic principles of the doctrine of Christ. And when Paul wrote to the Hebrews, he said, let us go on to perfection and maturity, not laying again the foundation for these things. And he said, this we will do if God permits. In fact, he said, brethren, I couldn't speak to you as spiritual men, but as babes in Christ. He said, I gave you milk to drink and not solid food, for you were not able to receive it. It's interesting, in the book of Revelation, it tells us that there's no sound of the millstone in Babylon. The reason there's no sound of the millstone in Babylon is because there's no true grain. There's no true corn of the word. And we're seeing more and more entertained, when we're seeing more and more compromise. But one of the things that those who are wise are seeing, they're seeing a couple of things. Daniel says, those who are wise will understand. There will be cosmic signs that are observed, and there will be earthly signs also that are observed. And there are things all through Scripture. There are things and events which preceded previous rescues in Scripture, and these things are described. There are patterns throughout God's Word. One of the patterns that God's people can see is that His people do enter into tribulation, but they are rescued out of it. They may be surrounded with no way out except by God's intervention. We saw that in the book of Exodus prior to God's people leaving in the Passover. We saw it in the book of Joshua when Rahab hid the spies and she hung that scarlet cord out of her window, which is a picture of the blood. We see that picture of the common thread of redemption, a picture of that scarlet cord of redemption all through the Word of God. And Rahab and her family were saved because they received the spies and they believed the report. They were completely surrounded, but God saved them. In Psalm 83, we read about God's people being completely surrounded. In Acts 12, when some were surrounded, they escaped. And there's increasing persecution. That will continue, beloved. And the persecution of God's people will come through political and religious apostate groups. And we can liken that to King Ahab and Jezebel in the Old Testament. We see those two wicked ones, King Ahab being a type of political Babylon and Jezebel being a type of religious Babylon. Increasing persecution, they were chasing after Elijah, wanted to put him to death. And again, that same spirit put John the Baptist to death. And let me tell you, this pattern will repeat again, because those of you who are forerunners, who are speaking up, all you John the Baptists who are declaring the word of the Lord and saying, make his path straight, and is warning God's people of to flee from the wrath that is to come. Those who walk in this kind of calling, you're going to be pursued. We see the pattern of the moral debauchery, that which is perverse and strange. The strange seed of Genesis 6:4, when angelic beings came down to earth, had relationships with women. We're seeing the strange gods. We're seeing the strange fire in the body of Christ. That's in Numbers, the book of Numbers. Nadab and Abihu, who were priests, were offering strange fire. That happened then. It's happening now. Jude 7 talks about strange flesh. And we know the book of Hebrews talks about strange doctrine. That's a pattern we see in both the old and the new. We know that violence and murder and devaluation of human life is decreasing, increasing. There's false doctrine, occultic practices. There's a famine in the land for hearing the true word of the Lord. But there's also the eating of the unleavened bread and preparing for departure. We see that even when the angels came to Lot, he had bread prepared for them. In Exodus, as they were about to exit, they had unleavened bread. In Acts 27, when Paul was on board and the ship was being hit by a hurricane, he said, I want all of you to eat bread. We're seeing there may be a famine in the land of the true word of the Lord, but there's also the eating of unleavened bread, that which will nourish the bride in preparation for departure. That's a pattern we can see in God's word. So God is going to supernaturally feed and prepare his people, not only physically, but he's going to provide that meat, that spiritual meat to sustain us as we meet together in small groups, even as Jesus set the people down in groups of 50, even as the sons of the prophets were sitting down and others in groups of 50, we see that the word and the food that will nourish the sons of the prophets and the bride will be there, and they will be fed, and they will be satisfied. Now, the use of the word night and darkness is also a description of the spiritual climate that is used with regard to a rescue and when Jesus appears. We know that in the parable Jesus told in the with the foolish and the wise virgins, we know that the call came at night. Behold, the bridegroom comes. We know that 1 Thessalonians speaks of that, the book of Revelation, that Jesus comes as a thief in the night. He will be coming to snatch his people. Praise God, hallelujah. So there are things that we're observing, patterns in Scripture. Also, apocalyptic judgment comes from above and beneath. It's both the action of God and the activity of Satan, who is still the god of this world. He is the prince of the power of the air. We see in Genesis 7:11 that the fountains of the deep were broken up. We saw things coming from above and beneath. And we see that also in the book of Revelation, chapter 6 to 20. Also, there's an instruction given to flee to the mountain. Jesus warned the disciples in the Olivet Discord. And he said, when you see these things happen, flee to the mountain. leave everything behind and run. So he's talking about being pursued with the persecution that happened in 70 AD. I believe that was partially fulfilled, but there will be a future fulfillment of that as well. Some of God's people will be told to flee and to go, beloved, and we need to be ready to go when he tells us to go. Lot was told to escape to the mountain. We know that Noah's ark rested on Mount Ararat. Glory to God. So there are patterns that we see in Scripture. There are things, as we know what Jesus said in Isaiah 46:10, it says, Jesus declares the end from the beginning. Beloved, if we want to know what's going to come, we have to look back. There is nothing new under the sun. The book of Ecclesiastes tells us that which has been is that which shall be. We see patterns. And by the way, there is no new revelation. What's happening is Jesus is just lifting the veil from the eyes of his people. He's breaking open seals. And when he does that, when things begin to be lifted, that's what the apocalypse is. It's the unveiling, the revealing of the Lord Jesus Christ and that which is coming. He reveals what is coming and he builds upon present truth. But again, some of the mysticism and the Gnosticism and the weirdness that has penetrated the NAR and the Dominionism camp and the leaven that we're seeing come in. And again, it is leaven that is lined up with truth. So we have to go to the Father, beloved. I'm telling you, every prophecy, someone gives you a prophecy, every dream, every vision, we have to take it to the Lord because, beloved, we will not be able to tell the difference if we are not spending time in the Word of God. He told us to meditate day and night. We have to bring everything to him. The counterfeit is deceptive. He is subtle. And the enemy would want to get every single one of us running after lying signs and wonders and false words and false prophetics. I could tell you story after story, ministering publicly since the 80s, some of the things that people have told me that they got a word from so-and-so, and they believed it. They did not take it to God. They married the wrong person. They did foolish things. They simply didn't take it to the Lord, and they paid the consequences later from the poor choices that they made. Now, people mean well, beloved, but we need to ask the Father, again, deception being a primary sign of the Lord's coming. Also, I want to say something about earthquakes. Because in Scripture, both contractions and dilations, okay, which are signs of travail that Jesus talked about, also earthquakes, tremors, and shaking are also the biblical language of travail, and earthquakes being associated with resurrection and rescue also. We see that when we read about the events that accompanied the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus and the raising of those that were in the graves. Were resurrected and walked through the holy city. Beloved, these things are in the Word of God. And so with the breaking of the first four seals, the fifth seal then that is broken marks a shift from the mere beginning of birth pangs to strong labor contractions. At the fifth seal, Revelation 6:10 tells us that it is a plea by the martyrs for divine retribution, okay? So this is widespread martyrdom. John heard the voices of the souls that were under the altar, and they were each given a white robe and were told to rest. But by the time now, the sixth seal is broken. And I just want to share, I just want to present this to you, and you pray about it. The breaking of the sixth seal introduces a cosmic phenomenon and a great earthquake, according to Revelation 6, 12 to 14. Now, this earthquake could be a side of, effect of beings being cast to the earth, because I am absolutely convinced that as some will fall to the earth, others are going to rise to the heavens. So it's very possible that this great earthquake is associated with the dead in Christ rising and the rapture of the saints. So tremors and shaking and earthquakes are also part of the biblical language of travail. And we know that the woman of Revelation 12 is a picture. Let me just break this down for you. Eve was the woman to whom the promise was given, okay? And that was in Genesis 3. But the woman in the age of grace is the body of Christ, okay? Galatians 4 tells us that. The woman at the end of the age is described in Revelation 12. And the woman in eternity future is the new Jerusalem. Now, I've heard some say that the woman only points to Israel. Others say it only points to the church. I believe it encompasses both in what I just shared with you. And these maternal contractions ease up and stop. So there are periods of rest and respite between these contractions, but they return with greater intensity. My concern is, and I was listening to the Lord, Father, what do I say to your people? I don't know what to tell them. What is on your heart? He said, tell them to stay close to me. Don't let them fall back into some kind of ease or state of thinking, all right, everything's going to be fine. We're going to get back to normal, because that is not the case. There will be things coming with greater intensity. But the good news about every crisis that we face and every calamity that our nation or the world may encounter is that these are instruments or vehicles to help refine the church and for us to be drawn closer to the Lord. And we know that the beginning of sorrows, right, is going to progress, but we are nowhere near where we are going to be. And others have likened these events to being like a domino effect. Once it starts, it's going to progress quickly. And I am impressed that that is going to be the case, because we saw within a week or two, our life was changed overnight. It seemed like we woke up one day, everything was different. And so I want to encourage you that with the breaking of the seventh seal, I do not believe God's people will be here for that, and I'll tell you why in a minute. The seventh seal was broken, and Scripture says there was silence in heaven for a half an hour, and John saw seven angels given seven trumpets. Now, the seventh seal unleashes the wrath of God. The word of God is clear that God's people are not appointed unto wrath. And God's saints are rescued prior to this. I want to read a scripture to you from Job. Job 5:19 says, from six troubles he will deliver you. Even in seven, evil will not touch you. Now, again, there are little clues that our Father will give us throughout the Word of God to confirm not what we would imagine in our minds to be in order, but he will confirm his order of events. He will explain his word to us as he knows we have the capacity to receive it. Also, we're told the dragon stands before that woman waiting to devour her child as soon as she delivers. Now, the dragon points to Satan, the persecutor. That's what Revelation 12, 4 and 9 describes him as. Now, the serpent points to Satan as the seducer. As the original seducer who seduced Eve, and we read about in Genesis chapter 3. Now, I'm almost out of time, but I just want to wind this down really quickly. In the Old Testament, Joseph's mother, Rachel, I believe, portrays an outstanding prophetic picture of the church at the end of the age. The Bible tells us in Genesis 35 and 45 that Rachel was in hard labor to bring forth Benjamin. Benjamin was Joseph's younger son. These were full brothers. Joseph is a strong type of the Lord Jesus Christ. One of the things that we understand is typology in Scripture is that Joseph and Benjamin portray a first fruits company. They belong together. Joseph, being a type of Jesus, Jesus removes our reproach, right? With a Savior coming into the earth, And in faith in his perfect sacrifice, he removes our reproach, even as the birth of Joseph removed reproach from Rachel because she had been barren. But again, Joseph and Benjamin were full brothers. So this concept speaks to us about the experience of sitting with Jesus in the throne as a full brother. Again, the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. This is what is happening now. Christ is being formed in us, okay? And Joseph gave all of his other half-brothers changes of clothing, but to Benjamin, Joseph gave 300 pieces of silver and 5 changes of clothing. Now, the scripture was clear in recording that for us. We know the 300 is symbolic, a type of the overcomer. We can see that number pop up associated with the overcomer. For example, there were 300 in Gideon's army. There were 300 shields of beaten gold that the king had that were reserved in a special place. So 300 speaks of the overcomer. And 5 changes of clothing speak of the great grace, and I believe even pointing to the fullness of the picture of Christ as apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. This is a full-grown group. So Joseph's silver cup being placed into Benjamin's sack speaks of his years as suffering in slavery, and he put that in to Benjamin's sack. So there's some outstanding things we can see here, some parallels that we can draw. We see a corporate son, the ruling partner, because he that overcomes will sit with him in his throne, and he that overcomes will rule the nations with a rod of iron. Now, Joseph told his younger brother Benjamin that you're going to stay with me, Benjamin, but the other brothers can go back to their own homeland. So Benjamin's name means the son of the right hand. So this is a picture of the ruler. It's a picture of Jesus and he that overcomes, the son of the right hand, sitting together and having a work to do that the other brothers did not have a part in. Also, Judah quoted Joseph and told his brother, they told me, okay, remember, they told his father, we have to take Benjamin back to Joseph, because he said, you will not see my face except your brother Benjamin be with you. So prophetically speaking, the face of Jesus will not be seen until his elect come forth. Hallelujah. He will return with them. This is the corporate son, the ruling partner. And even as the woman Rachel was in hard labor to bring forth Joseph's brother Benjamin, the birth of this son, the son of the right hand, will cause a travail in all of creation. And as his birth approaches, there will be a cry of pain and anguish of great tribulation upon earth, and the man-child will be born. There will be a manifestation of God's sons. Hallelujah. This is what all of creation is waiting for. So, beloved, let's hasten the coming of the Lord, 2 Peter 3:12. Let's use those opportunities to make disciples and to share Christ, because when the number of this ruling partner is complete, when the father is satisfied with his development, his overcoming son, then Jesus' face will be seen. God bless you, Brother John, and thank you for letting me share.
Oh, wow, great. Powerful, powerful program again. Very exciting and very motivational, too. Praise God. Thank you so much, Terri, for joining us tonight. It's just always a fantastic blessing to have you, and I look forward to it all the time. Matter of fact, we got to get you lined up for the next one, so I'll send you an email real quick right after the program with the next available date. But thank you again so much. And again, a wordindueseason.com, just like it's spelled, a word in due. DUE season.com, and you can get more information from Sister Terri and get prayer and things like that as well. So thank you so much, Terri. God bless you.
Thank you, John, and God bless you too. Bye-bye.
All right, everybody, hang in there. Things are going to shift and change. Might be a little bit of respite, but be buckled up and take this as an opportunity to get even more ready than we are right now. Amen. Praise God. And we'll see you all this Wednesday night, Lord willing.